Podcast.
Like that?
You have two new messages.
What's the other line?
Please pass.
Please pass the pod. What a cool job.
Be Mr.
You
Move.
You have two new messages. I always used to wanted to do the robot voice when I worked at Amex.
Yeah.
Just like, but it sounds better if you waver a little bit, so it sounds like a more technical. So right. You're like, you have two new messages. It doesn't look great, but I mean,
it sounds awesome though.
Autobots, roll out! Like it gives it that natural.
Do the Sam.
Sam, put the cube to my chest.
Yeah, it sounds like Optimus Prime is talking into a fan.
I would like a new glass of water. Thank you for calling into American Express. How can I help you today? Like,
it's like a southern robot.
I had changed like an accent in there. I could tell. Anyway, but, what's up, everybody? This is Taryn with Taryn the Hype. This is a new Taryn the Hype podcast. This is episode number 7. This is going to be recorded on November 16th. I don't know why I said that.
I don't know why you dated it.
Date the show. Fantastic.
Whatever, it's fine.
But anyway, the reason I might have dated the show is because you guys are fans. This is all for you. You Patreon special subscribers out there are going to get the episode the next day, tomorrow morning.
Yeah.
So you'll get that, you know, bright and early so you can enjoy your morning coffee, get a bagel you might throw up on launch day of the console, but whatever. That's an old story.
One of these days. So many stories.
But anyway, this is the Taryn the Hype podcast. We hope you guys enjoy it. Anyone who's not paying for it on Patreon, you guys will actually get the episode next week, usually on by Tuesday morning at the latest, Monday at the earliest. So look forward to that. Again, if you always want to subscribe to Patreon, it's at patreon.com/TarynTheHype. And we're going to have a good show.
I'm excited.
It's going to be a good show. Yeah. Now, I got to put my little cheat sheet here. No, we're looking. I am joined by my special guest here, the Crafty Krillin Flip. How about the play everything Matthew Marquez?
No, don't go. We don't need to burn through all these names.
Just one
in episode.
Okay, so
Crafty Krillin Flip.
Out of the two, which would you prefer?
What was the other one?
The play everything, because you know PlayStation thing is play everything,
right? So. Yeah, no, Crafty Krillin Flip would be better.
Okay,
out of those two, maybe we need to have like a tournament bracket where you give me two choices every week and then we whittle it down.
We could do that.
Okay. Because there's been a couple of good ones.
I have like 15.
Okay.
For today.
Sounds about right.
So guys, we're going to go ahead and get started here. Now, very first and foremost, the most important thing is, what have you been playing lately?
I've been actually playing a little bit of Overwatch lately.
Nice. Anything?
So there's a new update that just came out this week. Yeah. Came out yesterday. Spent a while updating it, but I was playing it for a while tonight. They added a bunch of new game modes. They redesigned how loot is dropped.
Really?
With the loot boxes, and I like it a lot better. So originally,
because it felt like a grind so much.
Yeah, and like I didn't like that you had to wait so long to get loot boxes and stuff. But now, so they redesigned how the game's menu is laid out. So you go into play games. And there's either the quick play, which is what quick play always was, where you just jump in.
Yeah,
and
whatever match.
No holds barred, whatever.
Yeah.
But then they added another mode called arcade mode. And inside of arcade mode, there's 5 different game types that you can play. There's a 1v1 mystery hero pick. So, like, you're playing against only one other player, and you're just doing...
Full-size map?
No, it's in a special map that's just for it to do 1v1.
Oh, okay.
And it randomly selects a hero for you every match,
really?
Every turn. But you get matched up against a person who's the same hero. So that way you're not like...
Oh, that'd be fun.
Like one of you is way more overpowered than the other. So that's pretty cool. And then it's a 1-to-5 wins. So like every round when you get a kill, that round is over, you get the point. Then it cycles to a new mystery hero for both of you, and then you keep going till one of the people wins 5 matches.
Okay, so it's the 1-to-5 wins.
Yeah.
It's not like best out of 5, it's the 1-to-5.
No, technically it's best out of 9, but it's 1-to-5. So it plays pretty well. It's pretty fun, and the map is small enough that it's fast to find people if you're actively trying to.
So it's not like you're just like on a flat platform disc. And
no, it's actually... Okay. So it's like... It's very symmetrical where it's... You start out on either end of this little icy gorge. It's maze level. actually. It's her world or whatever.
I was gonna say.
And then, like, there's two paths that split to go into one of two buildings.
Yeah.
And they're both fairly similar, where they've got, like, multi-levels inside of them. And then in the middle is, like, an open area that you can kind of fight in. And then there's, like, a center pole in the middle of it, so you can kind of, like, strafe around it. So it's really well designed.
Okay.
And it's really fun. Hmm. I lost the first time I played the 1v1. The second time, I must have got matched up with somebody who doesn't play very often, or they were playing on their friend's account. Because I destroyed them.
Really?
Granted, I got really lucky with the hero picks. People that I was good with.
Junkrat?
No. I got the soldier. I got McCree. I got...
Nice. Are you getting better with McCree?
Yeah. Been doing better with him. Still, some games are really good. Some games are terrible with him.
I've been trying to play with more of McCree as well. Because I needed more of an offensive player.
He's good. He's a good one. And he still has, like, the mobility and stuff with his dodge roll and stuff. Okay. I did a game with May. I did a game with the Russian girl that I can't remember her name. The tank. I want to say Zarya. That might be her name. I can't remember. I never play as her. I don't really like her. And then there was somebody else. I don't remember who the other person was. But I swept them in five.
Okay.
So I'm like, there's no way. I'm not that good. Like, I'm pretty decent at the game, but I'm not. I'm not going to sweep anybody.
Yeah, I watched some of the tournament, the world tournament that was at the BlizzCon.
Yeah.
And I'd like to be able to compete with that whole announcement they're doing. I'm never going to be able to get to that level, but I think it'd be fun to actually play some competitive matches and learn some of the tricks and stuff.
Yeah.
Because it's such a good community. They're so driven. But I've been, you know, that I normally play with support classes because I usually watch the game in full, you know.
Yeah.
I play with May or Mercy.
You like to help people more than be offensive in there.
And it's very different from how I would play, like, by myself. But I want to, like, have a, you know, I like to be also unique. Like, when we play Smash Brothers.
Yeah.
I like to be able to, no matter who I am, to be able to, like, kick your ass.
Yeah, you do like that.
So,
or Mortal Kombat.
Or any fighting game. I'll pretty much... Whenever I buy a new fighting game, my kind of rule is, like, play a random for, like, the first, like, 100 matches. So that way I can get kind of familiar with everyone.
Yeah.
And then I'll pick out who I want to get really good with. But anyway, I've been playing more of McCree as well as Tracer.
I still am so bad with her.
I've actually been getting pretty good with Tracer. I got a play of the game with Tracer. Nice. I was pretty hyped about that.
That's cool.
So... Those would be my offensive backups. I can't. Yeah. The only thing with Tracer, like, her defense is so low.
She's really squishy.
Yeah. Like, you take it, she takes it and she's gone.
Yeah.
McCree, not so much, but. Yeah.
So, that mode was really fun. The other new mode that I played was it's a 3v3 elimination mode. So, when you are killed, you're out. Like, that's it.
Oh,
and
wow.
It's, you're trying to, again, win 5 matches out of 9. With your team of 3, and you can switch in between rounds. You can pick a different hero.
So it's
and
just a deathmatch.
You can only have, yeah. So it's just deathmatch. It's in the same Arctic
So location. Condensed map. Okay.
Yeah, it's really small, easy to kind of find the other people. So that was pretty fun too. I had a lot of fun. I got matched up with a team the first time that did pretty good, but we just couldn't pull it together. And then I played it again and had a team that we. Took us a couple rounds to get in sync, and then we just kicked ass.
Okay.
So that was fun. Nice. And then the other cool thing, sorry, just
no, I like 3v3. I want to put that too. I like the smaller teams.
Yeah. And then they still have, like, the 6v6, the brawls are in there as, like, specific game types where you can only pick certain types of heroes, and it just picks them at random.
Okay.
And
the next one?
And then there's just the standard whatever kind of goes fighting, but you can only pick one hero. For your team, only one person can be the hero for your team.
Oh,
so just to kind of pare down on everyone picking one player or whatever.
Now you also said that the leveling system is different, the loot system is different now for the
loot. So they're a lot more generous with their loot boxes.
Good, they need to be.
When you go into arcade mode, there's a few different ways you can earn the loot boxes. So when I logged in, there was 2 game modes that. For my first win of the day, so the first time I did Elimination, the 3v3, and the first time I did the solo 1v1 Mystery Heroes, the first time I won each of those game modes, I got a loot box.
Okay.
And then there's a tracker up at the top that I think it tracks for the week, that for every 3 wins, you get a loot box up to 9 wins, so you can get 3 more loot boxes for the week.
Really?
By getting your 9 wins over the course of the week. and then every day there's two loot boxes you can get from so game types.
I mean, is it the same every day? Is it like weekly and daily challenges, or is it just like a set thing for the day with the timer restart?
So
there's a limit.
I think the game mode loot boxes for the first win is just a daily, and then that should rotate to kind of encourage people to play the different modes. But then the other one is just a general 9 wins in any of the arcade modes. Every 3 wins in the arcade mode will get you a loot box.
Nice.
So I played for about half an hour tonight, almost 40 minutes.
Do they have to be consecutive?
No, it's just every time you get a win, it ticks off another box.
Nice.
Yeah.
Oh, I'd totally be down to play more.
So I got 3 loot boxes in half an hour.
Okay.
And then I almost leveled up for my overall level, and we'll be getting another loot box that way too.
Oh man, I'm going to jump on.
Jump back
in there a little bit.
Yeah, I like that, because that was the one thing I didn't like. Well, one of the things I didn't like about it was it took a long time to get loot boxes after a while.
Yeah, I mean, that was one of the things, like, in the very beginning, you're like, oh wow, this is cool, I'm getting loot left and right. Mm-hmm. And it's because you're leveling up so fast, because you're so low. But, I mean, the grind later on, I know they want you to get the more expensive stuff.
And I have bought loot boxes, but that's not as fun.
Yeah, but see, the thing is also with those bosses is it's random. Like, so, I mean, even if you're taking forever to get something, you might just get, like, the second tier costume that, you know, you just haven't unlocked
yet. Costume? Dude, I unlocked a box tonight that I would have been really pissed about, but since it was easy enough to get, it was 3 sprays and 1 player icon. So I was like, okay, that's something at least, but I didn't care as much because I'd already had 2 other boxes. So, it's nice. I really appreciate the update. Very player friendly.
Nice.
And I haven't
still have the link where if you're playing with a friend, you get the bonus, right?
Yeah, I believe so. Okay. You can get bonus experience and stuff. I haven't played as the new character yet, though.
Sombra.
She looks cool. I played against her, kicked her ass, but I have not played as her. She seems pretty cool, though.
Okay. Is she difficult playing against? Did she see in the OP at all?
No, she didn't. But the people I was playing with probably hadn't played with her very much because she just came out yesterday for PlayStation owners. So a lot of her abilities focus on shutting down other people for like crowd control type stuff.
Yeah, more
like
support.
She might be kind of but she's actually classified as an offense character.
Really?
Yeah, which I thought was weird, but it's just because she has a machine pistol and.
She can make people freeze, right? That's one of her abilities.
Yeah, she like shuts down people's abilities, and then she can go invisible so that you can't see her. And she goes completely invisible. You can't see shit when she's invisible. Like, she snuck up on me a couple times.
It's like, I'm Predator. I can see the outline of you.
Yeah, no.
It's not like Mogar Saw. You're the green guy who's supposedly not being able to see
you.
You're fucking invisible.
Couldn't see anything going on. So, she seems pretty cool. Her ultimate wiped me out twice from different people on the other team using it.
Really?
She does like an EMP blast, which like completely shuts you down and you can't move. And then just everyone else can kind of wipe you. It's kind of like May's ultimate,
so
but
you can,
it's faster.
So her ultimate makes it so people can't move.
Yeah.
How long does that last for?
Not very long.
I wonder if it's a fast charging one like Mercy's or if it's slower.
I don't know how
that'd be fun to play
up.
As
she seems cool. I want to try her out, but I haven't got to it yet.
I think it'd be fun being able to like shut people down like that, because usually when you freeze someone or anything that stops them in their movement, they want to use an ability right away because it's been charging while they're frozen.
Mm-hmm.
So if you could actually piggyback those, like do the special, freeze them, and then right when it's about to end, use the trigger to where they can't use a special, you could go to town with that pretty good.
Yeah, it seems pretty cool.
Hmm.
And honestly, it seems like a character you would like. An offensive character you could get behind.
Yeah, I might have to
with her abilities. She's kind of more of a sneaky and screw around with the other team, basically.
That's what I do today. I mean, you've seen me play. I don't like
I know what you like.
I'm not so much like, oh, I want to be the best killer on the team. I'm more like, I want to piss them off so much and just tease them. Like, even when we launched the matches as May, I'll like just stand in front of the starting point and just launch walls.
Yeah.
And then like right when the wall goes down, they'll want to kill me because I'm standing right there so angry, so I'll go with my shell. And then everyone's just standing there trying to shoot me, and they don't really think about moving it, so I'll put up another wall when I come out of my shell.
Nice.
And I get so upset, and I just, that brings me pleasure.
Yeah.
So, good times. Well, I'm glad you're enjoying that.
Yeah, it's been fun. So awesome. What about you? What have you been playing lately?
I've been playing Call of Duty. Not a whole lot, but enough to beat it. So I want to talk a little bit about Call of Duty, if you don't mind, now that I've had a chance to get some hands on.
I'm very curious as to your notes on this.
So with Call of Duty, I play Infinite Warfare. I picked it up at Redbox and took it back the next day. I think I maybe played that night, just like the intro, to see what the story is going to be like, how the characters act, and how the game moves. So like maybe like an hour, not much. The next day I played it and beat it. So
okay.
So I mean, I played right through it. I think I stopped once or twice for like a snack in the bathroom. So
a snack in the bathroom, or snack.
Take it as you
will. And bathroom.
Take it as you will.
Hey, you know, you gotta do what you gotta do. You gotta play, so. At least you got up to use the bathroom.
Now, am I saying I've ever had a full, like, triple cheeseburger, fries, and a Frosty while sitting on the toilet taking a dump? That's neither here nor there. Topic for another day.
Another day. Another story for another day. Story of TMT.
For you guys who aren't watching the camera, that's gonna be fun to sound. No, but like I said, it very kind of took me by surprise. Like, I had my expectations kind of wavering. The beta kind of had some things go up, some things go down. I know that yours, like you mentioned as well, on our podcast, we've talked about it, kind of made it feel sluggish to you.
Yeah.
It really wasn't. Like, it actually was very responsive. I felt like I was in control of them very well. I mean, it was fun. I've played, I think, all the other Call of Duties besides Black Ops 2.
Okay.
So I've beaten them all the other ones. So this is nothing new for me. But, and I've beaten a few Battlefields. It's that there's a lot of things I like about it. And it's Call of Duty, so I want to let you know my opinion first off the bat. I mean, I know that it's one of those classic games that everyone loves to hate. Like,
right.
Like, oh, it's Call of Duty. I hate this game, but I want to go play it when I get home, like, sort of thing.
Right, yeah. Never going to buy Call of Duty because it's the same game every year. Oh, new Call of Duty's out. I got to go buy a Call of Duty.
Yeah, but it's like, it's kind of like, I have to buy it because I kind of have to buy it. Because
everybody buys it.
Yeah.
But everyone buys it because everyone
It's still a fun experience. So that's the thing, is that the story seemed a little short, right?
Okay.
I mean, I probably beat it, like, 5 hours. Wow. Maybe six.
That's really short,
though. Now, here's the thing. They've actually gotten a lot more creative with this one.
Okay.
When you're playing the story automatically right from the beginning, no real spoilers here because it happens in the beginning of the game, but you end up, like, being the soldier who's...
What? You're a soldier in this game?
No.
So dang.
You're a soldier who's well, like, well understood, like, well represented, well known, and okay. He goes up into outer space to, like, find out what happened to protect from, like, people attacking the village or the city, and he tries to recuperate and retaliate against them, and he goes up in outer space, and they realize that one ship crashes into another. He goes on, like, to find out what happened there, and finds out the captain died. He died defending his ship. Okay. So that's, like, the big thing of, wow. He's like, well, who's the highest person on board? He's like, oh, well, you are. He's like, the guy's like, well, guess your captain now. And, like,
look at me. I'm the captain now.
Exactly. And he's just like, well, given the position, pretty much. And so he has good morals. He's a good guy. He wants to do the right thing. Blah, blah, blah. And so that's how you end up getting the whole outer space aspect of it. Mm-hmm. Then when taking outer space. So you're literally pretty much like Commander Shepard without the RPG element. So you're like, you go do these missions. You find out who the bad guy is. He's pretty much... That's one thing I didn't like. The bad guy was Jon Snow.
Yeah, I heard about that. I don't know. I don't like him as a bad guy.
He looks like he's been stung by a lot of bees because he's a lot more fluffier than he really normally is in Game of Thrones. So, but he does a good job as a bad guy, but I never really understood what his main goal was.
Okay.
Like, his final goal was, like, he just seems like he's being an asshole.
Okay.
Like, I'm a bad guy. I have my own army. I have my own military. We're going to keep killing you guys. You can't stop us. I'm like... What's the reason? Like, I never got that. That was never, like, established in the game.
Okay.
So that was one thing that bothered me. But the premise was cool. Like, you know, you have a bad guy, you have a good guy. I'm gonna go find you and kill you.
Yeah. Good premise.
They brought in the smaller aspects of things to where they're not just like normally with Call of Duty. You have a linear path. Hey, you're here. Follow this other comrade to get here. Yeah. Kill people along the way.
Right.
You know,
right, right.
A B shooter.
Yeah.
Now it's like, you're in outer space. You can float it around if you want to. They'll turn the gravity off. You can, you know, shoot like normal if you want to. You can bring people closer to you, or you can go further away. You also have options to choose what mission you want to do.
Okay, so, I was going to ask you about that.
So a little bit into, like, a few missions in, that comes up to, like, all right, Captain, well, what do you want to do next? Like, and they'll give you, like, a little briefing of what's going on. And then it just brings up into this main hub in your captain's deck of the entire solar system.
Okay.
And so it shows you, like, here's a story mission, here's a side mission, here's the mission for your spaceship. We have to, you know, and each one has aspects to where you feel like you're actually playing the story.
Okay.
But you're not. And it's really cool. Hmm. I'd say each one of those missions probably could take you in between 15 to 45 minutes.
Each one of those story missions or each one of the side missions?
Each one of those both? Side missions.
Okay.
Yeah.
That's a pretty decent side mission.
Yeah. And so I was like, wow, this is kind of really cool. So I felt bad for Pluto not being a planet. Now it is a planet again. So I went to Pluto first.
Oh, of course.
And it was cool because like when you do one, you unlock other ones. So there's that. There's more gameplay there.
Cool.
When you go to some planets, will have two missions at them. One will be like, oh, well, this is a mission where you have to do things in your plane, or this is a mission where you have to try to sneak into one of their big star destroyers and sneak around and then destroy them.
Okay.
It's kind of back and forth between those two options. But the way that they approach it, the beginning is different every time. The way that it ends is different every time. And so it was really nice having that choice about how I wanted to play the game.
That's cool.
The other thing that they added is like more of an aspect of kind of collectibles. Not so much like Uncharted where, oh, I found a treasure in the ground. It's shiny, it's sparkly, but I have to go pick it up. But more like there's this, since you're the captain, like you go into your captain's quarters and it's this entire board like you're an old detective and you have all the needles and pins going to the main person.
You're like tracing everything around, right. Whatever.
But they're all question marks except for the main person. So while you're going to the planets and it looks at all the planets, it says, oh, there's two of the agents here. You don't know which one they are, though. Oh, and there's five here.
Uh-huh.
So if you choose that side mission to go after those five people, you might end up only killing three.
Okay.
Then you're like, oh, you can go back and try to find more.
Interesting.
So there's replay value back to each mission, too.
Okay.
And then there's, that's a trophy, too, like knocking out half the board, knocking out all the board.
Yeah.
So I thought that was a really cool aspect of how they did it, too.
That's fun.
It makes you want to do that, but then also says you have to do one side mission before you can do a story mission at the beginning.
Okay.
So that's how why I was like, I want to try these out first, get my hands on them. After I realized, I got to take this back to Redbox pretty soon, I'm like, let me just do all the story missions.
Okay. I was going to ask you how many story missions you did versus side missions, because your 6 hours of gameplay seems like it would be
two side
primarily
missions.
Okay. I figured it was primarily story and not really
it was.
Diving into
So that's the thing.
Sides.
About 5.5 to 6 hours of gameplay, but that was straight story with two side missions.
Got it.
And those are my first side missions I did too.
What level were you playing on? Like a normal difficulty?
I always play on normal.
Okay.
I know that from a developer aspect that they always say that they want to make the game as challenging for you, so please bump it up whatever you think is necessary for you if you're experience wise. But they say the way the game was meant to be played for to enjoy the experience is normal.
This is the default setting.
Yeah, the default setting, that's why it is default.
Shit, I was playing other games this week too. Yeah, I just didn't know where you had to take it back right away if you bumped it down just so you can kind of experience it and get through the story faster.
If I really want to like grind the trophies or if there's like this is too easy for me, I might bump it up. Like I've done that before on previous Call of Duties where I'm like, this is way too easy.
Yeah.
I'll bump it up to like harder or expert, but I never bump it down. I'll never bump a game down to easy or less than normal. So, but The thing about it was, like, the characters did a good job, too. Like, they delivered the story, a lot of, like, kind of catchphrases and, like, wanting to be, like, I'm Mr. Badass, but I'm here for my comrades. I want to have good morals, but I have to make this decision. Really good moments. There were a lot of really good moments, like, that you can't really put yourself in the position of here on Earth.
Okay.
That they actually use the environment with, like, wow, I couldn't imagine having to go through that. And that's what we mentioned on our podcast previously with the compare and contrast, was that Call of Duty is a big action-packed blockbuster. It puts you in the front seat of having to go through these experiences of, oh, what if this person dies and you're in their perspective? Or what if you have to go through this and you're in their perspective? So it really actually captured me more than I thought it would. So I think that game actually did a really good job. It wasn't as much content as I wanted to have, but I'm pretty sure if I played through all the side missions,
that would have felt better.
That would have been more of the money's worth for it.
Did you play any of the multiplayer, or did you only stick to single player?
So I played a few rounds of multiplayer.
Okay.
I just did quick play. I did one capture the... It's not capture the flag, but it's pretty much capture the flag. I did like one or two matches of that, then I did just a few matches of Team Deathmatch. But that was about it. It's very similar to the beta.
Okay.
It didn't feel as slow and sluggish, though.
Okay.
Like, when I jumped somewhere, it responded where I thought I was going to land. Like,
okay.
If I shot in an area, it shot that area. It didn't like, I'm going to aim here, but it's going to just go fucking crazy. The other cool aspect about that was, too, is that before you start each match, normally you can choose, like, go to an area and, choose your presets for your weapons and blah, blah, blah. And that never changes unless you go back there. Well, after every mission, they're like, whenever you choose a side quest, like on the planets, it also tells you here, you have if you beat this mission, there's an upgrade for your spaceship. If you beat this mission, there's an these upgrades for your character slots.
Okay.
So you can choose, like, oh, I want more character slots. I want to go to this side mission then. So, like I said, it really gives you that choice. And cool. Those reflect in the loadout screen after you start a mission. So
okay.
It was very very choice-driven, and I think that's what made me more immersed into it.
Yeah.
Cool. Any other questions you had about it?
No, that was kind of it for that. Yeah.
It was fun. I mean, I would actually...
Have you played Battlefield 1 or Titanfall 2?
I played...
Like the releases?
Not the releases, yeah. So Titanfall 2, I'm wanting to pick up because it's coming around for Black Friday pretty soon. Battlefield 1, I'm probably going to rent and try to like play through the story because I've played through the story of 2 and 3 for Battlefield.
Yeah.
But it just doesn't appeal to me. I mean, it doesn't jump out saying I want to play this. I'll probably play it to have an opinion about it instead of wanting to play it.
Yeah.
Kind of like I did for Call of Duty, though.
Right.
But Titanfall, I actually want to pick up.
Okay.
Now, with this, though, I'd say for Call of Duty, I know that they're always trying to get more fans because that's what they do.
Mm-hmm.
Coming down to this aspect of things, it was very easy to pick up. It's very clear about making things easy for you to learn. It's not very complex when it comes to the shooting mechanics. I mean, this is the prime real estate here. This is what you want shooters to feel like, and it's very simplistic. It's the classic aim and shoot.
Mm-hmm.
Another cool aspect about feeling like an RPG without being an RPG was that you unlocked weapons for your loadouts
by
picking them up on the ground.
Really?
Yeah.
That's pretty cool.
So, I mean, it wasn't like, oh, you beat the level, now you can have these guns.
Yeah.
Or it wasn't like, you're fine. So it wasn't like, you leveled up to 4, now you've unlocked this gun.
Now you get the gun.
Yeah, it was more like, you're shooting whatever gun you have on your loadout, you go into the map, you start, you know, fighting bad guys. They drop weapons. Whenever you come across it, you can pick up that weapon and drop yours. And it does this little flash thing, like going, oh, look at this. And it does like a scan.
Okay.
And then it says added to your inventory. So when you go back to the next mission, you can choose that weapon if you want to.
Cool.
So it's kind of like, it makes me want to go find more guns. It makes me want to try new things instead of just saying, well, I got this, I know it works, I'm going to kick some ass now. Like,
yeah. It's not the traditional, I got to this level, so here's the new items that I happen
like,
to...
I've already gotten this far in the story. Obviously, I have the best stuff. Like, I found new weapons on the last level.
Nice.
So it was fun.
It's cool. How did the weapons feel? Because
that was one of my downsides.
They're a little more futuristic-y feeling.
That was actually my downside, is that they all felt kind of the same.
Okay.
I'm like, there was a cool mechanic that they tried to incorporate to where, I mean, it's not really groundbreaking, but you have a rifle, and it can either switch into a rifle or a shotgun, and it turns it sideways to shoot a shotgun for some reason.
Sure.
And there's a scope on the side for a shotgun, I don't know.
Better range on the shotgun.
Yeah, but then they had the mechanic to where you had an assault rifle, and then you can adjust it and switch into two pistols.
See, I played with that gun in the beta, and I liked that gun.
There are 3 guns that do that.
Really?
Yeah, so that was the cool thing, is that every gun had to alter firing method.
Right.
Either it was assault rifle to single shot, or assault rifle to sniper, or assault rifle to double pistols, or assault rifle to shotgun.
Okay.
I found 2 or 3 that I really enjoyed, but I didn't find myself using it that much. Like, I found myself like, well, this one does more damage.
Yeah.
Or this one's more effective. I don't need to go back.
Okay.
The only time I would go back is when I've upgraded the scope to use on the assault rifle. To use, like, those special moments.
Gotcha.
But it was actually more difficult, I found, because when you shoot with the double pistols... when you shoot the double pistols, it's like that. It's like, it's not like he's aiming both at the same spot, the same reticule. It's actually like he's aiming really bow armed and at 2 different points that are more crossing at. So it was harder to use those.
Interesting.
But the thing I think what they did is they made up for it by making them like assault rifles.
Yeah.
So instead of going pop pop pop, it's so you have a chance to hit more things regardless if it's on target or not.
That sounds like a different weapon than what I used in the beta then.
Yeah, like I said, there's a few different ones.
Yeah.
I didn't unlock all the weapons, of course, but I unlocked a pretty good portion.
Yeah.
I enjoyed it. Like I said, for people who are really big veterans out there, I think that you're going to enjoy this Call of Duty. I think it was actually, it's like Black Ops 3. It was kind of remastered, redone, and a new fresh idea, and they executed it very well. I think like this one is definitely in the step in the right direction for... I think Treyarch did this one, right?
Infinity Ward.
Infinity Ward did this one. Treyarch did the Black Ops. Whatever that was. okay. But I know the next one is the team who does Who did Ghost?
I want to say Sledgehammer, but that's not right.
Yeah, it's
Sledgehammer. Is it?
It's Sledgehammer. Okay. So the next one is going to be Sledgehammer, who did Ghost last time, which is a big downfall for the company. A lot of people hated Ghost just for, like...
It did not go well.
Yeah, it was. I think it was the story aspect people hated so much.
Yeah.
But I think this is definitely a step in the right direction. If you are an experienced gamer, if you love Call of Duty, if you want to constantly play shooting games, that's all you play... This one has a lot to offer you. It's going to have a good story. It's going to have replay value finally for once. You don't have to just skip it or even play it once. You can play a lot of different missions different ways. As well as a multiplayer, there's a lot more maps. There's a lot more content. There's a lot more modes. And the fact that you have low gravity instead of just shocks on your feet for jumping higher is a lot more interesting to play. So cool. I would recommend it for both, for inexperienced and non-experienced. For hyped and unhyped.
Sorry if you mentioned this earlier and I wasn't listening. Sure. So you're unlocking things in the story by finding them in the missions.
Mm-hmm.
Do those unlocks carry over to multiplayer, or do you have to play multiplayer and level up there to unlock weapons and mods?
Exactly, correct. So multiplayer is a little bit different. You have to actually level up there to get the unlocks.
Okay.
But I actually took a book out of Overwatch's book. A page out of Overwatch's book. It's like a book out of Overwatch's book.
What?
It's three books, cool. You know, short stories, whatever. But so what it is that you actually get loot boxes now.
Okay.
So they have dailies and they have weeklies. And if you get those, you get special loot boxes.
Okay.
Now, they also have, you know, low loot boxes and high loot boxes to where you can actually choose. I want to get some, this one. I kind of know what I'm going to get. It's like mediums, commons, right. Against rares and...
Mediums.
Yeah,
against lots of RPGs.
Rares and ultra rares. I had to compare it to something. So that's what their system is now. Like, you level up, you kind of get points to unlock those.
Okay.
Or you can just keep the basic unlock that you get.
Gotcha.
And you also get like a skill system for choosing what, you know, class type you want to be. So it's still very intricate. Like I said, a lot of options, a lot of unlocks to go through, but it's a little more organized now.
Okay.
As well as up to you how you want to random drop it.
Yeah. In the beta, I really liked how they kind of laid everything out. I like the loot box idea. I think that works out pretty well for leveling people up. And it doesn't really punish people for coming in late because they could still technically randomly get good stuff.
Exactly. So that's the thing that with Overwatch, you're unlocking things like that's cosmetics or emotes. In Call of Duty, you're actually unlocking like attachments for your weapons.
Yeah, or better gear.
Yeah, or gear or things that are going to help you blend into the environment.
Yeah.
So there was a likable character that I really liked who was actually a robot. He was just an AI companion robot. And the voiceover work who did that was fantastic. I actually felt like really connected
to him.
Connected for him being a robot. And I think that was the entire point. But like even just playing through the games, I'm like, I wonder if they take it this way. I wonder if they take it this way with the story. I'm like, I wanted to know how it was going to turn out. So I wasn't just playing through it to play through it like I started with. I actually gained the momentum to want to continue the story on my own. So
nice.
Definitely recommend whether you're hyped about Call of Duty or not hyped about it. Pick up this one. It's a good place to start.
Cool.
So let's go ahead and get started with the show.
Yeah, let's get started.
Now, before we start, has anything going on with you recently? Any life events you want to talk about?
No, nothing okay. Exciting.
Funny story I want to bring up. Happened tonight. is that before the show, I have to get cleaned up around the house, you know, try to get things as picked up as much as possible, not only for my peace of mind, but for
the
families as well.
It was all right. 7 out of 10.
Hey, that's good to me. That's great. So
C's get degrees. I mean, come on.
So I was a little sweaty, and I don't want to wear those clothes because I've been wearing them all day. So I went upstairs, and I was taking a shower, and Jordan was laying down. I had the door closed and everything, and you know, Leo was in his cage. He went downstairs to go to the bathroom. I got in the shower, and and all of a sudden, I hear just Jordan scream, like somebody's in the house, like about to, like, kidnap or scream.
Great.
I'm like... shit. So
here comes wet naked Taryn.
Yeah, so that's exactly
beat up a robber.
So I mean, I'm not gonna point out right now, I didn't pause. I want to make sure that's clear. I didn't pause. I mean I stopped what I was doing. Of course I was gonna come out of the shower, but I was like shit, Jordan's in trouble. And the very first idea that came into my mind after shit, Jordan's in trouble was shit, I have to fight someone naked.
That was my first thought. Was, here we go.
Oh my god, it wasn't like, oh, I could get hurt. Oh, this is dangerous. Like, who's outside? It was like,
I'm naked. I'm like freaking riding.
I need to protect my wife. I have to protect my wife. And I have to protect my wife naked. So I was like, shit. So
did you do naked cartwheels out of the room?
Actually, it came out in a cardboard box, so it was even better. Perfect. Just with the edges cut out, flapping on the ground, you know, very quiet. But I wanted to share that because that was a very funny experience, and I'm pretty sure we've all been there.
So what was it?
What's the story there? Leo came upstairs, and she didn't hear him. Oh, she was laying down on the bed sideways watching TV. And so my side was all open.
Yeah.
And he jumped up on the bed. She thought like something was coming at her.
Got it. Okay. You really should have left the story there and not finished it.
I was thinking about it.
Just to see. Because that would have been pretty funny.
If you didn't know, this is the number one podcast where you guys get to choose a review out there. Just like listening to Call of Duty, you can choose if you like it hyped or unhyped. Mm-hmm. It's going to be good for you either way. So check it out. But let's go get started with the hype of the day.
Hype.
Now, if you want to follow us more often, you can follow me on Twitter at either TarynTheHype, which is our show, or Augie272. That's me personally. And Matt, you are on Twitter
at KrillinFlip337.
Do you prefer me introducing you, or do you want to just be quiet and let you introduce yourself, or me just tell everyone what yours is, and you can be like, that's me?
I have a voice. I can say my Twitter handle.
Oh, I have a voice. Sorry.
You ask, so...
But also, if you guys have a Patreon, you can follow us on there. We have quite a few fans on Twitch now. Had our stream recently. And if you want to send in your questions to us, but you don't want to be on Patreon, Twitter, or any social media, send it at Gmail. It's TarynTheHype@gmail.com. Again, it's TARYN for Taryn. Now, the world of hype is the very first thing I want to bring up is that Voodoo recently announced another update. I'm going to slow down. Let's take a deep breath. Okay, I need to slow down my talking pace. Get a little more comfortable over here.
Welcome to this evening's episode of Taryn the Hype, the World of Hype. Tonight we're going to be discussing Voodoo physical copies and their impact on the consumer's buying habits.
Very well done. Okay, so that's actually absolutely correct.
Yeah, I got it. There's minimal notes. I was like, we'll just... take this to its logical conclusion.
I try to hint at it so you don't know what I'm going to say, but you can kind of just... So Voodoo recently announced that they're actually going to partner with their own movie companies to whatever they have on there, instead of being strictly digital. Mm-hmm. If you buy a Blu-ray on there, you can watch it right away on Voodoo, and it'll be on your Voodoo account. But we will also send you by mail a Blu-ray copy.
Okay.
I know.
What's the difference between that... and going to the store to buy my Blu-ray copy that has a Voodoo code in
it. That's exactly the point.
There's no difference.
Now,
Voodoo makes money off of it this way, though.
Sorry. Exactly. So, I mean, I looked at this, a few different things. There was a movie that came out recently. I think it was Finding Nemo or Finding Dory.
Yeah.
The thing with Voodoo is that you get the movies on there exclusively 2 weeks before they come out.
Yeah.
So if you order it, you can pre-order it and get it before launch.
That's every digital service I've found.
Now,
Apple does that for digital movies, and Disney's digital service does that as well. They offer it 2 weeks in advance.
Okay.
Sorry, just
to be clear. I completely agree with you. I'm aware of that as well. And Disney actually is partnered with Ultraviolet, which was with Voodoo. So
yeah,
they work with that. But with this, though, is that you actually have the convenience of, like, instead of having to go to the store and pick it up, you can do that. If you want to debate that, that's not my point at all.
Right, things redundant.
The only thing that I was thinking about myself, I was like, man, I wish I had this with music.
Interesting.
So, I mean, we're coming to the technology day of age where you go to the store and buy a movie. It's always either DVD and digital copy, DVD and Blu-ray and digital copy, Blu-ray and digital copy. Everything has digital copy. What the hell, iTunes? What are you waiting for? Where is my... Oh, here's your new Linkin Park CD, and here's the digital copy for iTunes.
iTunes isn't going to give you that, though.
I know, but what?
They don't need to.
They could make so much more money.
But
think about it. Think about how... I'm looking for a consumer's perspective.
Okay.
I think I spit a little bit on you. I'm sorry.
Did you? Whatever, I didn't know.
Maybe that's the glitter you still have. It's distracting. Probably. But, so, you go to the store.
I think I got it.
You have... iTunes is the biggest, you know, medium market out there. You go to the store and you buy the new, what's the new CD?
Linkin Park. Let's go with that.
The new Bruno Mars CD comes out like in a few weeks. There you go. You like Bruno Mars?
Not really.
Oh, okay.
He's a little whiny for my taste.
No, I understand that.
He's all right. Some of it's all right, though.
So you buy the new Bruno Mars CD or Fall Out Boy. They have a new CD coming out, right?
Sure. I don't know.
Give me a band.
I don't know. I don't follow that much music.
All right, so
I've become old. I listen to the same music.
Well, good thing I didn't date myself with all the bands I just listed. I don't care. I just want a band name.
I just listen to Pandora anyway, so it doesn't matter.
Pandora is a good band. All right, so
okay.
So you buy the latest CD, right? How great would it be that I get this CD? I have the physical. I don't want. You have to take it home. You have to put it into your CD drive if you have a CD drive for all the new Mac users out there.
Yeah, you're screwed.
And then you have to import it. It never imports all the information. It gives you a list. Oh, which CD did you talk about? These are all named the same exact fucking thing, but we have several different versions of it. Like, oh my gosh, I don't know. Now I don't want to have to worry about importing the wrong thing. Like, why can't you just say, here's your CD, enjoy it in your car, wherever you are going to enjoy it. Here's the code for the digital copy. Go to iTunes, redeem, and it's there.
See,
it would also work better with cloud services too.
Yeah. Like, I mean, so they would need to do a different code, because like you said, you can bring it home, you can put your CD into your computer and rip the CD.
But here's the thing.
But you have to manually load that music onto your device. You don't just have access to it streaming wherever you go.
But that's the thing. That's exactly the point I was going
right,
to bring
that's,
up. So
that's why it would make a lot of sense.
So iTunes has their iTunes music, and the majority of the population has either iPhones or Android. You already have your market. You could redeem your code on the iTunes store on your phone, start listening to your CD you just bought right then and there. And then you can put the CD in when you get home, or put the CD in your car later on. Like,
yeah.
You could take it with you. What if I want to go at the mall, which I never do, but what if I go to the mall, and I'm like, oh, this is a really cool CD. Let me open it up, redeem the code. I can listen on my phone while I'm still shopping at the mall, instead of having, okay, well, I have to go to my car to listen to this, or I have to go home to listen to this.
Yeah.
Or I have to go to YouTube to try to listen to the song.
But then,
like, it would just be a huge convenience, and I feel like everyone's doing this but music.
But you know what's an even more convenient thing? I'm just going to go on my phone and I'm going to go purchase the album straight from the source. I'm not going to worry about buying a physical media for all these players that don't exist anymore outside of a car.
I understand. It's the phase of transitioning to getting rid of CDs, right?
Yeah.
But people are still buying vinyls. People are
going to true. Keep, yeah, people are gonna always going to be buying media. But
yeah, but they're going to come.
They're dying out. It's more of a niche thing.
Maybe it's media's more being sad and disgruntled about it instead of actually a good idea.
Sorry. Well, okay. Take it to another logical step. Steam, you buy digital games. You don't get physical copies of it. It's all required to be online so they can give you the license.
That's
code.
A fan service. I'm buying the games to download
PS4
it for free.
PS4 games, you've bought a lot of digital copies of stuff. You don't get physical copies with that.
Yeah,
I go buy physical copies for discounts, but it sucks having to swap stuff out. But I don't get a digital code when I buy a physical copy.
Are you a fast Googler?
Yeah.
You think you can find out what's the percentage of people who prefer physical copies over digital copies? Of anything? Digital over physical? Let's resolve this right now. Because, I mean, I'll vamp for a little bit. Because, I mean, if we can find that point, I don't know a gamer who I've met who's like, yeah, I just have it digitally. I have the physical too, but I just play it digitally. Like, they prefer the physical copy. You're that way. I'm the same way. Yeah, there's some games that I have digitally, but I prefer to have the physical copy if I can.
See, it depends. Like, some of it I'm okay with having physical. Some of it I'd prefer just only doing digital. It kind of depends on what it is. Like, if it's just music, I've bought a number of albums just digitally on iTunes.
I can't buy physical
and
music.
It doesn't make that much of a difference. The only time when I really care about it being physical is if there's something else that's coming with it. Like if there's an art book, if there's a collectible, if there's something special about buying it physical that makes me want to do the physical commitment
there
as
is.
Opposed to
it's
digital.
The case.
Okay. I mean, yeah. I mean, I still buy all my movies physical. I don't buy anything digital as a primary. I get digital copies as a bonus for buying physical.
You always buy the DVD
or
Blu-ray
digital
with
digital. The digital.
That's what I do too. But that was just one thing that was grinding my gears I wanted to bring up. And just, I'm like, why haven't... I know we have this for this reason. I know we have iTunes for the reason.
I don't see anything that's super easy either.
I know we have iTunes for the reason to buy it right away. I know we have CDs to get the CD if you want a physical copy. I just don't know why they haven't combined it yet.
There should be an option, because physical media is dying out. I mean, it just is. Everywhere in the stores, it's shrinking. People are going more towards digital and streaming. I think the movie industry had it right. you buy the physical copy, we're going to give you the digital version free. So you can do either way.
That's what I'm saying.
So like other media should follow suit. I totally agree that it should be an option.
It will also, like, if they even did this, I mean, what is it? A code they just have to generate?
Yeah.
It's not a lot of programming. It's not a lot of work. I mean, a lot of people have already done it too. But think about this. If they're really wanting to push people going digital, this will actually push them more, like, in the long sense. If people are like, oh, I got a code now with my song and I can get the whole thing on them. Oh, that's, like, I'm not sure how I feel about that, but I'll try it once. And then later on, oh, I actually like that. I hope that more CDs do that. They'll spell more of those. And it'll lead to, oh, I'm actually comfortable having digital copies now. I'm going to stop buying CDs.
Yeah.
I'm not wanting to get rid of the market, but I'm saying it'll help them in the transition, and I think it'd be beneficial for everyone.
Yeah. I just think because music was on the forefront of the digital revolution of people moving away from a physical media, that I think music got a really bad taste in its mouth with Napster, with Kazaa, with all this shit that ate into the bottom line of the music industry. I think they're very skittish and standoff.
That's a good point.
And they don't want to push into that more than they already are because they're just not comfortable doing that. They don't have a good history.
Napster.
With digital, yeah. Sorry, music industry. It was free. I was young. What can I say?
I never did it again, and then Kazaa happened.
And then LimeWire and BearShare and a few other places.
That, thanks for giving me a rebuttal about that. But I just that was something that caught my attention. I thought about. Next thing coming out is we had a few things. I'm actually going to talk about Black Friday shopping.
Okay, that's coming up next week.
Yeah, so we, Black Friday is next week. It's actually literally a week and 2 days, so 9 days.
Yeah, that would be a week and 2 days. 9 days. Yeah.
I almost said 10 and I had to correct myself in my head. So
good job.
But anyway, I know maths.
Once in a while.
The only thing is, this is another kind of gripe that I wanted to say, is that GameStop sucks at deals. Their deals are horrible. I mean, becoming an avid gamer throughout my entire life, you always had this one game store to go to. It may have been Babbage's, it may have been like other stores out there, Toys R Us, you know, Best Buy, Target, but I mean, when it comes to Black Friday, that's the biggest sales day of the year. You guys suck at it. I'm talking to you guys directly at GameStop. You guys, like, honestly don't know what you're doing. So you're trying to find out.
Hang on.
No.
So what?
No.
Before you get too far into this rant, come off your soapbox. What is so bad about their deals this year? It seems like there's always a few pretty good deals to get you in the doors, and then some other stuff that's decent.
It's not competitive.
Okay.
Is it?
I haven't. Full disclosure, I have not looked at any Black Friday deals. I've been waiting for them all to come out, and I'll look at them all at once.
So, I mean, they really do a good job. I'm not going to fully badmouth them more than I have to. But
I will. I'll throw them under the bus.
But is the fact that they keep their market to what is best for their income, to where right now making money for them is best with used copies.
That's always been their focus.
Right, and that's very obvious for everyone to see. Anyone who goes in there and talks to them about deals will understand that the used market is where they make their money at. Now, the only thing is that Black Friday is the biggest shopping day of the year. Their best deals are come in and we'll give you extra bonuses for trading your stuff. Come in, sell us your stuff to get this thing for free. Come in.
Really?
Yeah. It's like,
that's a pain in the ass.
A lot of it is either like focused around trading or buying used copies. You know, here, buy four, get this for free. Or buy four and get this special discount. And it's nothing like that that bothers me. I mean, those are great deals. But when it comes to their just prices being dropped, Overwatch at GameStop is $45 on Black Friday. That's still a drop. That's great.
That's pretty good.
But Overwatch at Target is $30 on Black Friday. Best Buy is $35.
Yeah.
I mean, come on. I think a used copy of Battleborn, which is going free to play, at GameStop on Black Friday is $20.
It's on sale on the PSN right now for $8, by the way.
Exactly. on the PlayStation Network before Black Friday, on a regular week, is $8. On Black Friday...
Oh, no, I lied. It's $30 on the PlayStation Network. It's $8 on GameFly right now.
On Black Friday at Target, it's $10.
Nice.
Yeah, I mean, come on. Like, you guys... They have a lot of cool stuff in there. Like, they have toys. They're trying to go more retro now with Nintendo and things like that. They have some things that no other places have. But the problem is that they know that. But the thing is, they're not... I mean, we're gamers. Just like consoles. Like, we want to have... Like, cater to the gamer. Like, I know you guys are a business. You're trying to make money. I know that you have your market you're trying to cater to. But this is one day out of the year for your chance to get people coming into your store that don't normally do it. If you don't have decent sales to compete with other stores, they're not going to come to your store.
You're making me play devil's advocate all night tonight. Because here I am. I'm going to stick up for GameStop, the company I freaking hate.
Let me read your comment real fast. When I said, GameStop suck at sales. And Matt's note next to that is, ha.
With three exclamations. Because I find that hilarious. But, all right, GameStop is having a horrible time trying to stay afloat. I mean, they expanded into all these other businesses. They have collectible trading cards. They have pops. They have toys. They have merchandise. They have all this other crap.
Let's stand up for a minute.
That 5 years ago, they did not have nearly as much. They had, like, one tiny little cardboard display set up with, like, wallets and hats and whatnot.
But all that excitement was getting me a little...
Getting you a little hot and bothered?
It's hot for winter.
It is. It's finally cooling down a little bit. So
it's that these lights make it really hot.
Yeah, that's so true. We do have a few extra lights.
My kitchen lights already made it hot, so it didn't help. So.
Yeah. So GameStop is very much in a bad position. They aren't making the numbers that they want to, that they need to keep their company going. The only way that they make money, their primary way of making money, is used game sales, because they buy low and they sell high. And that's how they make their big returns. Because if they're selling new copies, they're only making like the 10 or 15% of the sale price. Right. If they're selling used copies, they're making 50%, usually more, of whatever that sale price is. So Their margins are way higher there.
It is 50%.
So, yeah. So they're obviously going to push that. I think it's interesting that this year they're pushing that. The trade-in values and trade and use deals more than they have in the past.
And again, that's my perspective from what I've seen looking at all the sales online.
Yeah. So that's interesting that they're trying to do that. That to me shows a very big sign of desperation that we can't make our numbers with new game sales and what we would have to cut out of our end of it. We need to push the used game market where we do make good money.
Well, and honestly,
hope that we can make it through a Black Friday.
Whenever I go into a GameStop, I feel like they're just swimming in crappy inventory. That's the problem, is that they have so much inventory of like, hey, give us your games back, give us your games back. Shit, we don't have any of the good stuff anymore. Like, we have... It's like going into a movie... I can't say that in comparison now. But, I mean, it's the fact that, like, instead of having only one or two new copies of the brand new game coming out, they only have... I mean, instead of having like 50 copies, they only have like one or two. And so slow people are going to get that deal. But we have all this other like, you know, half-assed or old shit over here. Why don't you come get some of that and we'll give you credit or we'll give you a deal on it. Like it's...
Well, that's...
I think that's the problem. They're spending so much money on bad inventory.
That's their own grave that they dug for themselves of, hey, bring us your games. We'll give you money so you can buy new stuff. Oh, you brought us 5 years worth of Madden games? Fantastic. We're not going to give you crap for it, but we'll take it.
And we'll resell it.
And they're going to sell it. And then over time, their inventory just bulks up with a bunch of crap.
Yeah.
That's the nature of the beast of primarily dealing in used games and inventory.
Yeah. I literally talked to GameStop on the launch day for Infinite Warfare. And it was to where they will give you $25 store credit for you know, a $60 game,
right?
But that's taxed at $65, so it's less than half. But it's, if you're a reward member, it's $32, so it becomes half.
Yeah, but then they would go around and sell that for $55.
Yeah, it'll be $55, so $5 off.
So yeah,
it's just sad.
Yeah, it's a business.
It was just a gripe that I had, an observation.
That's really weird, though.
If you're looking at a Black Friday list, I mean, you can look at GameStop yourself, but definitely if you're thinking about buying some games, look at Target and Best Buy. Beforehand as well, or Walmart or Amazon. Definitely some other better deals out there for you. Hmm. So, just that.
Ha! Ha! Suck at GameStop.
Moving on.
Anyways, I'm done defending them. They're terrible.
Very fast topic here. I want to get to the hype of the show. But thing I want to bring up was there were two remakes that are coming out. First one is Beauty and the Beast.
Yeah.
The new trailer dropped this week to where you actually can see some of the actual footage
from the movie.
Yeah, seeing what it's actually going to be like. As well as The Ghost in the Shell. There's an actual trailer for it now. Which would you like to talk about first?
Since you didn't write Ghost in the Shell on here, let's start with Beauty and the Beast, and then we'll do Ghost in the Shell.
Well, Ghost in the Shell is brought up to me by one of my patrons. So it was
let's go there first. Okay. Didn't know that was... Got it. Looking out for you guys.
So yeah, you guys are subscribers. You get your you're in for first. So, did you watch the original anime?
Yeah, I like the original anime.
Okay.
It was a while before I watched it, but I finally got around to it.
And you've watched the trailer?
Yeah.
How do you feel?
I don't know. I thought the original anime was pretty cool at the time. I was high school age, so 13 or 14 when I watched it.
Mm-hmm.
Watched it, I don't know, half a dozen times. I liked it. I thought it was fun. It was one of the first, like, kind of more adulty, a little more out there
mature,
anime that I had watched at the time, as opposed to watching Toonami stuff. So, like, it felt cool and whatnot, and it was all right. But then, like, watching more Ghost in the Shell stuff afterwards, like the other versions of it and whatever, I'm like, all right, well, this is other movies, this is cool. So it kind of got diluted a little bit for how good it was, but I'm so on it. Yeah. I have no feeling one way or the other towards the remake. I think I'll go check it out. I'm interested in it, but I don't have too hard of a feeling one way or the other.
Did the trailer look good to you?
I think so. I think it looked good.
Awesome.
I think it was interesting the way they interpret some of the animation for it.
Yeah.
And I'm curious to see how the actor's doing it.
Yeah, I think that you're spot on with my feeling too. A few things that I have is that I feel like Ghost in the Shell was one of those bigger animes out there. I feel that if you're going to get into the anime world and you want to start watching more mature animes, I feel that Ghost in the Shell is kind of a rite of passage.
Yeah.
Just like Ninja Scroll and Akira is. I think that you kind of need to have those in the repertoire for watching before you can actually...
I've never watched Akira.
Shh, don't tell anybody. I won't tell. but... they're going to make a live-action Akira anyway. They haven't announced anything with Ninja Scroll, but I feel like those are kind of the bigger names out there when the anime was first getting started for coming to the Western culture.
Mm-hmm.
So Ghost in the Shell is more of like more mind games, more intense, more gritty. I'm not so worried about the movie. I think the movie looks good.
Yeah.
I think the live action looks good. I think that Scarlett Johansson's going to be fine with it.
I have no problem with that.
I don't have
she
a problem with it either.
Doesn't look Asian in the anime. I don't see any problem with it being a white woman as...
But
yes,
here's the thing I have with Scarlett Johansson. She's a very popular actress now.
Yeah,
I'm not worried with how her performance is going to be. She's done roles like this where she has to be very robotic and very, you know, see through and seamless.
Yeah,
but it's the fact of her being a big name star of what they might do with her being more fashion-y and more, you know, more out there, more fashionista. What's the word I'm looking for? More of a movie star, than the main character was in the actual movie. Like depicting Ghost in the Shell's main character, she was more like, "I'm here to do my job. This is my job. This is the right thing to do." And she was kind of a more nitty gritty person. She did whatever I had to do for the job. I'm just worried about them taking her and making her more glamorous and more, you know, stylish. And when it doesn't have to be done, it's not part of the story. It's not where that originated from. So they've gotten the look right. I'm just worried about how much time they spend with that particular look that they're going to do when it's not necessary. I don't want them to overstep their boundaries. So that's a little small caveat worry that I have here.
Okay.
I think that it looks good so far. Obviously, the writers have already said that they're going to change some things themselves. They're not going to follow it verbatim because they don't want to just remake the movie.
Right.
It's going to be, you know, some creative differences from the original, but that's where they're getting all their inspiration from.
Mm-hmm.
So I think that it looks good. I think that if you're a fan of anime, and if you're a fan of Ghost in the Shell, you've watched it, you like Blade Runner or movies like that, or if you like movies where cyborgs and robots and, you know, mind and hacking stuff like that, you're going to get more into it with a lot of flashy cinematography. I think you're going to enjoy this movie. If you don't like Scarlett Johansson, don't watch it. If you don't like robots, don't watch it. If you don't like futuristic, you know, cop dramas, don't watch it.
Yeah.
So that was one of my worries, but I think it looks good. I definitely am going to watch it because I was a huge fan of the original.
Yeah. My biggest worry was how are the visuals going to hold up? Because obviously there's a lot going on in the anime.
Mm-hmm.
Just with the style and how everybody looks and how they all walk in the city and all that kind of stuff. And the only complaint, the only thing I didn't really care for in the trailer was, I can't remember his name, but it's the guy who has like the robot eyes.
Yeah,
the like little camera circle.
Yeah, they're really small.
I really don't like the way he looks.
For eyes, pretty much,
I don't like the way he looks in the live action version. It doesn't look appropriately sized or something. I don't know. There's something about him that feels off.
The quarters are a little too small.
Yeah.
In the anime, they weren't that
proportioned
properly.
A little bigger, but yeah.
Also, in the live action, his head's more round. It's more like an Adam Sandler egg than actually like a Guile Square.
Yeah, he was a lot more like squared and blocky in the anime too, which kind of helped his head size.
One made him look tougher too. He looks he looks a little more softer, and he in the anime he was kind of a guy that wasn't like really this is not a big deal. We can face whatever's in front of us. He just wants to be there for his partner. Mm. In the live action, he's looks like he's actually like in danger and like worried about like the fight. Like he can't handle it. Like overwhelmed. I'm like that doesn't seem like that fits.
Yeah.
So. It's funny, I'm not so worried about Scarlett Johansson, but I'm worried about her partner, who's actually not a main character. But moving on, Beauty and the Beast, how do you feel about that remake so far, that trailer that you've seen?
I am super mixed about that one. I like the living stuff around the house, all the servants and stuff.
How they animate the face instead of actually looks cool. Make it move in like cars' mouths.
Yeah, so it's not like they just put a face on and eyeballs on these things. Like they kind of made it a little more natural.
It's not like Terrence and Phillip. I think.
I think Emma Watson. I think Emma Watson is a good choice for Belle. At first, I wasn't so sure, but seeing her in the role, she looks like she's going to do a good job. All the side characters, her father Gaston, and all the townsfolk. Sure, they all look like good townsfolk that are, you know, from this village, whatever.
Yeah.
I don't like the way the beast looks.
Me neither. Yes.
Thank you. There's something that does not look right.
His face is too flat.
I don't like the horns.
And he's too small.
Like, see, I don't think that. Like, I just don't like his face exactly. The horns are what bugs me.
Yeah, because they're straight up. They curl back.
They go back like it's his hair. And like in the original movie, they curled up.
Yeah, they were actually really short.
They were short, and they popped up. Yeah, like little horns. I assume that they didn't want him to look like a demon.
Yeah.
With like horns coming out, and so that's why they swept them back. But I don't like the way
like a slick back affair.
The whole head doesn't look right.
Yeah, it looks like he's
off.
He looks like a Belle's dancing with Groot. Like it looks weird. It just.
Yeah,
his nose too is really flat, and that was not how the original Beast was. When it showed like a really small clip of him going against the wolves,
trying to protect her,
like he looks so small in comparison with the wolves themselves, and that's not how the original Beauty and the Beast was. I mean, that's a small thing to complain about, but this is our childhood. Like this is what we grew up with.
So we've watched this hundreds of times.
Beauty and the Beast is tons of people's favorite, Disney movie out there. Is that so? Wanting them to get like the main character right is that it's a big deal. And if you watch the original, I don't want to say animated, cartoon.
Not animated.
Okay.
It's animated.
If you watch the original movie or animation, he's daunting in his size.
Yeah.
Like he's almost to the roof in any room he goes into.
He's intimidating in size, but he's
practically
not,
three times taller than Belle. Do you not remember the scene where he's jumping from like the staircase up to like behind her in that
room? Do you remember the whole entire dancing scene where they're almost the exact same height?
Well, they scaled him down for that.
When they're in the snowball fight and
he's still
almost
big in
the same size as she is.
No.
Granted,
no.
He's not standing fully upright, but
I want to see his hind legs. Because like they look like horses' hind legs in the cartoon. So yeah, I don't like the way he looks either. I'm also worried about Gaston. He kind of looks scrawny to me.
I thought the same thing, because I was like, that's Gaston?
That's Luke Pierre, whatever his name is, the guy who played Dracula, the new Dracula.
Oh, really? I didn't even look into see who he was.
Yeah. Are you looking him up?
No, I was looking up pictures of Belle and Beast together.
Oh, okay, to prove me wrong.
Yes!
So Gaston, I'm going to look it up real fast, is being played by...
Okay, he's about like a foot taller than she is right there. That's not three times
her
size.
Oh, yeah, so you look up the scene that you already said they're being scaled down for.
Well, then, okay, let's talk about the scene where he's obviously scaled up to be intimidating.
Look at the wolf fight when like when she's giving him a bath afterwards, like healing his wounds. He's huge. Okay, whatever.
I think you're on the crack. Also... They don't always draw people at the same exact size for every single scene when they're hand animating. Or when they're computer
animating. Luke Evans, that's what his name is. Luke Evans.
Sure. Name doesn't mean anything to me.
Jeez, now we're going to be... We need a vamp. Someone vamp.
All right. So here's an
Leo
image
vamp.
Of her.
How you feel about
Siri? So here she is. Nursing his wounds or whatever.
Yeah, look how big he is.
She's on her knees.
And he's hunched over. He's not even standing upright.
Yeah, but she's on her knees.
No, she's standing up.
No, she is not standing up.
Anyway, moving
so
on. So
the chair comes up to her chest then.
Yeah, it's a big chair. She it's a castle. You have tall chairs in a castle.
She kneels down in front of him, and she's like sitting all the way on her butt. Did. Whatever. We took it. We're done. We're done with this.
No, I'm just saying. So...
Done.
Okay.
Moving on.
Agree or disagree.
No, he's... moving on.
Okay, I said three times. You said he's just...
Moving on.
No. So you said that he's... we'll just agree that he's taller.
He's taller. But...
All right.
But he's not like...
I'm just worried they're going
to
make him look scrawny.
He's not like Andre the Giant compared to Danny DeVito.
I mean... Yeah, he is. All right, so here's all I'm saying is that my worry is that they're going to make him look weak or not as powerful as he really is.
Yeah.
That was my own concern. It's because, I mean, he's guarding his castle and he's really powerful.
Yeah.
I guess it's...
He's not... I will agree with you. He's definitely not as bulky as he is in the original cartoon. But that doesn't necessarily mean it's going to be bad. I mean, okay, let's look at other recent Disney re-release of Jungle Book. King Louie in the original cartoon, regular old orangutan size, not very big. He's about the same size as Mowgli, a little bit shorter.
I didn't watch the remakes.
But then the remake, he's a... Gigantopithecus?
Yeah, like...
He's gigantic.
He's the size of the building, pretty much. Yeah,
because he's like a special type of orangutan or something.
Yeah, okay.
So, I mean... He's my Joe Young. It worked, yeah. Apparently. He's like King Kong Jr. But, I mean, it worked for the movie. It worked as him being more of a scary, more of a villainous type of a character. So, I mean, it worked in the way that they did it. It was different than...
It made sense.
Yeah, it made sense in the story and the context.
Okay.
So, I'm just saying... Give it a shot. And we are totally playing off of each other today more than we normally do.
This is great.
I feel like I'm defending a lot of stuff today.
Yeah, it's fun.
Instead of attacking and tearing it down. Dumb, blah, blah, blah.
It's nice not having to attack and tear everything down. tearing it down. Anyway.
Oh, man.
They taught Emma Thompson how to...
Emma
Watson, yeah. How to have a French accent.
Emma Thompson is totally different.
How to have a French accent and have hair extensions, and so she's good there. Yeah. How about you feel about Ian McKellen and Sir Ian McKellen?
Yeah.
Being one of the Clocksworth.
Oh, he's Gogworth? Didn't even... Like I said, I watched the trailer, didn't care to look up who was anywhere, because I'm going to see it. I like the movie, I'm excited about it. Well, now I'm excited about it. First, I was a little...
Because Sir Ian McKellen's in there, right?
Oh, yeah, totally. Obviously, I totally influenced me.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
Man, we need to go see this movie together. Because I'm like, yeah, you suck. Like, you suck.
I always like Cogsworth. Lumiere was cool, too, but yes. I like Cogsworth.
So, actually, I think Ewan McGregor... No, Josh Gad is Lumiere. And Ewan McGregor is in there as well. There's also Dan Stevens and Luke Evans and Kevin Kline. So,
okay.
Maybe Kevin. Either Josh Gad or Kevin Kline or Ewan McGregor is a.
Somebody plays this character.
Whatever.
Thanks,
anyway.
IMDb. Oh, no, you're not even on IMDb. You're on Wikipedia. No wonder you don't have any information.
No wonder I'm wrong. But anyway, moving on. Definitely, I'm going to check it out. I just don't like the way he looks. I'm not worried about Ghost in the Shell. I think it's going to be great. Just worried about them emphasizing things they don't need to.
Yeah.
So I think that brings it down to the hype of the show.
I like that our opinions are like, yeah, we both disagree about the same thing. What the fuck? You don't agree with this at all. This isn't going where I thought it was.
We both disagree, but you're wrong. All right.
Anyway,
so
sorry.
The
hype of the show.
The hype of the show is Watch Dogs 2.
Yeah.
Yeah, so Watch Dogs 2 came out Monday night at 10 o'clock for me.
Yeah.
Because of the East Coast, so...
November daylight savings.
Yeah, November.
Stupid fucking daylight savings. It messes everything up.
Had to end a week and a half before the game came out. I couldn't play it for an extra hour.
Could have played it at 9 o'clock instead of 10. Stupid.
Even when I pre-ordered it 2 months ago, the PSN said it'll be playable at 8.
Lies.
Bastards. Anyway, so Watch Dogs 2 is a game created by Ubisoft, developed in Ubisoft Montreal, that studios. It's a $60 game. They have special unlocks for it. What the game is focused around is it's a sequel to... Watch Dogs 1, where...
What? I am surprised.
So what is in that world is pretty much like the world we have nowadays, but instead of having our different operating systems for our computers or our phones or our TVs, it actually has just one operating system called CTOS that covers all pretty much electronics for the city. And what it is this hacker group actually is wanting to, you know, pretty much Mr. Robot. You
go hack the planet?
Yeah. Hackers, hack planet, go down like evil corporations. There's someone being bad out there. We need to prove our, say our word, get it out there. That's what the game's about. And you are able to hack different devices. Now, before I get started into my opinion of it, did you have some questions you want to ask about Watch Dogs 2?
Okay, here we go. As we know, if you've been following along on Taryn the Hype shows, I am definitely not on the hype train for this one.
Yeah.
I don't know what it is or why I'm not that excited about it. Has not gotten me excited really at all. Like, it looks cool, it looks fun, sure, but I have not looked into buying it, haven't looked into renting it.
Haven't watched videos on it.
Haven't watched videos of it. Yeah. I barely read reviews on it.
Yeah.
So, as someone who is very excited about playing the original Watch Dogs because of the gameplay of being able to go through your city a la Grand Theft Auto and be able to interact with things on, you know, a systems level to get around and navigate and also defend yourself or attack bad guys. How does it compare from 1 to 2? Like, what kind of a jump is it? Is it more of the same type of gameplay just in a new city? Did they improve stuff? Is there stuff that's missing or not there that they refined?
So I think that
that's a big question, I know, but
yeah, there's a lot to cover in that question. So I definitely think this is a jump in the right direction.
Okay.
I think that they made huge improvements. I'm gonna try to slow down my talking so I can emphasize my points. I think that with Watch Dogs 2 so far, they've made huge improvements. They've definitely taken things that, as for fans, they wanted to do what fans are asking for, and they've been doing a lot better with that. Where fans didn't like Watch Dogs 1 because they didn't like the character, Aiden Pierce. He wasn't a believable character. Fans didn't like Watch Dogs 1 because the story was kind of repetitive and very boring. It was bland. I mean, he had one mission. It was to get revenge.
Yeah.
And you have a 20-hour game of content where it's to get revenge. So, I mean, they kind of had to wing it a little bit. The first game was also in Chicago. So it was a very dark, gloomy city. Wanted to have a lot of tall buildings, so you felt like you're in the city environment. Mm-hmm. But also have marshlands and wetlands out there too. Now, with Watch Dogs 2, I felt like it's I heard a comparison that was very agreeable. That this is kind of the jump with Ubisoft from Assassin's Creed 1 to Assassin's Creed 2.
That's what it feels like.
Yeah. There's a lot more different aspects when it comes to movement, when it comes to the environment you're in, when it comes to mechanics that you have to play with and use, and how those mechanics interact with the environment. So it's still the same game, but it's just done a little bit differently to make it better. Now, that was that person's opinion. I agree to an extent. I think that I'll go over those one at a time if this helps answer your question.
Okay.
With the characters, they're definitely very likable.
Okay.
You play as Marcus. Whatever his last name is. Mark. You play as Marcus.
Step like, your game
it's,
up.
It's Marcus still like PSP. Very classic, cheesy, last name. But you play as a character named Marcus, and he's in San Francisco. I'll tell you one thing for San Francisco. I've been there about 3 times myself.
Yeah.
They nailed San Francisco down. Now, when it comes to actual geographic location, it's maybe 40-50% of actual location.
Well, it's got to be all compressed down.
Right. You have Oakland as well. You have other different places you can go to, but it's very compressed. I was actually a little depressed with how big the map is. I was hoping it would be a little bit bigger. But with the feel of San Francisco, they've nailed it like 90%.
Okay.
The only reason it's 10% missing is because there's not enough homeless people in it. And maybe, the weather doesn't change. It doesn't change enough for me in the game. But
okay.
They've definitely nailed the feel of San Francisco. The buildings look great. The graphics look great. So that's on par. Definitely a better choice than Chicago was because there's more life to it. Now, with the group of characters that you meet with Marcus, you meet the hacker group. You guys call yourselves DedSec, which is...
Is that a callback to the first game? Wasn't Aiden Pierce in DedSec?
He was becoming a part of DedSec, but they were trying to recruit him, and he was fighting against them.
Okay.
Because he had his own plans. He didn't want to be a part of anybody.
Gotcha.
So he was trying to be a loner.
So this time around, Marcus wants to be part of DedSec, or he is part of DedSec.
When so the start? Very first mission is like your initiation into DedSec. So you okay. become part of DedSec right in the very beginning.
Got it.
The only thing with this story is that with the way they interact and the way they transition is they it's very, you know, uplifting. So it's not like serious like Grand Theft Auto, mm-hmm. but it's not very light like Saints Row.
Okay.
But it's not just here for a joke.
Yeah.
Like in cutscenes, they'll make small cracks or small one-liners, or they'll be very silly. You have your serious guy, you have your loner guy who doesn't talk to anybody like Mr. Robot. You have your charismatic girl, you have your very technological savvy electronic guy, and they all feed off each other very well. The dialogue's fun. They make little montages of the background music in between cutscenes. It's great. It's very entertaining. It just, there's something missing there for me.
Okay.
It feels like there's something missing when it comes to pulling me in more into the group. They feel like they're not as tight-knit as I want them to be. Like, he kind of just came to the group, and it's like he's been there for years.
Okay.
And not like you actually have to prove yourself. I guess, like, earning respect. That would have done something more for me. That's something I would have changed. When it comes to who you're going up against is the evil corporations. The bad guy is actually a really cool bad guy. You don't see him that often, though, which is one of the things. And when you do see him, it's for a very short amount of time.
Okay.
I think that later on he definitely could develop, but I haven't gotten there yet. I haven't beaten the game. Now, that's for the characters and the environment.
Okay.
The driving's good. Now, as I told you, it's a jump from Assassin's Creed 1 to Assassin's Creed 2. From Watch Dogs 1, you had a pretty much hack-all button, right?
Right.
You could go to the crossroads, and you could hack the light, push square. You could go to someone who's walking down the street and see what their title position is, how much money they make, and hack them and get money once, push square. The difference between this one and that one is the fact that instead of those options, you can still do all those things. I can go hack the street light, but instead of hacking it with one button, I have options to how I want to hack it.
Okay.
So you hold down L1 to hack whatever you want to, and instead of turning the street light on, I can say, I just want to disable it.
Okay.
Or I want to make it all red. Or I want to make it explode. So, okay. I mean, and you can choose what you want to do.
So you have a little more control to
Yeah, so hacks. You can choose how the environment interacts with itself.
Okay.
You also can go to a person, and instead of just saying, oh, I'm going to hack that person. And the first game would be like, whatever list there is what's going to happen. Either bomb's going to explode or you're gonna get a key. Now it's like, I want to hack them, and what it does when you're holding that one, you can use the buttons to push what you want to do.
Mm-hmm.
You can steal money from them, or you can hack a PIN card from them, or you can actually call the police on them saying they're actually a mobster and the police will show up, or you can actually make the grenade explode.
Can you do all those options every time you hack somebody, or is it still you have one or two options for each person?
So you can do that for it varies for what type of person it is.
Okay.
So it's like if you have an enemy that is a regular guy, then a mini boss, then a boss, they all have different things you can hack.
Okay.
Now the thing is that in the first game, it just was in your skill tree, gain the ability to do this.
Right.
And so you can just run down the street doing it and doing it and doing it. This one, they actually have a battery system to where whenever you use a hack, it has little like bars of, and it drains your battery.
And those so, recharge over time?
Right. And also, if you want, you can drain other people's batteries from their phones.
Hmm.
Okay. But that's not available to everyone. So you really have to kind of figure, oh, I want to do this hack, but it costs this much battery. Oh, on the skill tree, I want to use this so it'll make it so it costs less battery, things like that. So it really plays out itself very well.
Okay.
There's a lot of really fun situations that you can do. The only thing that I'm seeing so far is that I don't want to do a lot of the... I mean, I don't feel like there's a lot of hacks that should have been available. I feel like a lot of the hacks that are available are like, oh, this is a change to what was in the first game. But besides that mob thing or calling the police, there's nothing new here.
Okay.
That's the only downside I have so far about it. You'll hear a lot of other things, but I feel like, yeah, these are all the same things I did in the first game. Like, this hack was I did streetlights, or I had an explosion in the ground from a
gas main.
From a gas main. Or, I mean, these are all the same things that were in the first game. There's mm-hmm. nothing new here, but I mean, I can control them more, but I felt like kind of let down. I felt like kind of missing something when it came to the hacking ground. Now, again, depending on how you want to play it, there's three different ways you can play it. You can be either an aggressor, where you're charging with the guns and the ammunition and try to kill everybody. But the game really pushes you away from doing that.
Okay.
It says, there's one skill tree for the guns, and there's a total of, I think, seven skill trees. and the rest are for hacking. Wow. So it really pushes you, like, hey, don't do this. Even, I'm not sure if you've heard it online or anything, but Marcus is really a kind of easygoing, I want to do the right thing kind of guy. Yeah. He's there to, like, I'm here to make it better for everyone with what I'm doing with DedSec.
Yeah.
That it really doesn't feel right to use a gun.
That's what I was going to ask next, was how does the gunplay feel and how does it feel in the story? Because there's a lot of people who are saying that they don't play with the guns.
And I've heard that online, too. This is not just something I'm saying from online. This is, a personal opinion. But here's the thing, is that I think it really doesn't come down to how you believe Marcus is as a character. It depends on how immersed you get into the game. So there's two types of immersion, I feel, is that this is another topic for another day. But if you're playing a game, are you seeing through cutscenes, or when you're playing, are you seeing yourself as that character, or are you seeing that character as that character? What I mean is, like, when I'm going against the police and I'm shooting a shotgun at them, am I, like, immersing myself to where, oh yeah, I'm shooting the shotgun and going against them, or is it, oh, I want to shoot the shotgun because this is what this character would do? Mm-hmm. So, I mean, that's really where we got to draw the line. It depends on how you play the game. I find myself playing the game different ways with different titles. Again, like I said, we can dive into this a lot deeper another day. But if you play the game just like because you want to have some fun, it won't bother you. You're going to have more fun if you hack things opposed to not hacking things. It's going to also give you more of a challenge if you hack things and make for more funny situations and experiences. But you definitely can't play the game with guns. I mean, they even push it so much to where your default gun is a stun gun.
Nice.
So they really want to push you to the stealthiness. And it's fun having an open world of stealth. I mean, you don't get those very often.
Yeah,
so.
That definitely isn't very common nowadays.
Yeah. They also incorporate some newer things to kind of counterbalance doing the same thing that Watch Dogs 1 did by using a little remote control. I picture it as a mini Axel from Twisted Metal. The guy with the big wheels and his arms.
Yeah.
But it's just a little remote control car where it can actually hack things for you. Or you also get a drone that actually goes in the air and it can fly around. They both have the limits to how far they can go from you, so you can go far away. There's a lot of other small things you can do. Like, you can have a dirt bike race. You can have, like, little go-kart races. You can have drone races.
Mm-hmm.
You can also do boat races. I mean, there's a lot of really cool content that they added to it. Like, for side missions and main missions, they actually have a Uber in there. So you can be an Uber driver if you want to. It's not called that, but... you can go like, oh, I'm on duty now, and people will say, okay, come pick me up, go there. And they'll be like, oh, I gotta go pick up my dry cleaning. Oh, I have to go pick up my this and this. And the leveling system here is not for, like, experience points. It's called getting fans because of social media. You're trying to get more people to be fans of DedSec. So you level up by getting more fans, and some things will give you money, some things will give you fans. So you're like, what do I want to get? You get skill points by getting more fans. So, but you can also get more guns and drones and stuff like that with money.
Money.
So
makes sense.
So that's the balance there. Go ahead.
I want to take you back to something that you kind of covered and touched on. The secondary characters that Marcus interacts with.
Mm-hmm.
One of my other concerns with the game, watching all the preview coverage and stuff, they seemed very... what's the word I'm looking for? They didn't seem very... realistic, likable. They seemed
like they're totally super, cliches,
super weird. Yeah, very cliche, and not like they would be good characters to, like, interact with for an entire story. They just seemed really awkward, and there's a word I'm looking for and I can't think of it.
Yeah, so I mean, I was worried about that too. Like, they seem like characters I can just blow them off. I can just play the story on mute and not miss a thing with this.
Yeah.
But I mean, there's a few moments, I'm not going to spoil anything in here, but there's a part in the story where they actually kind of break apart. For like, oh, we've lost, we can't do this, they've found out, or they've, whatever it is, and you're like, Marcus is the one who wants to rally the team back together. And so, I mean, that kind of brings you back into it. Again, like, they are definitely tropes, so like, with like, oh, he's the guy who doesn't want to talk to anybody, or doesn't, you know, socially awkward. He's the guy who's flamboyant, but, you know, kind of very clumsy. But
yeah.
I mean, they talk so well with Marcus, and since you're playing as Marcus, if you're that type of player, you'll actually get along with them just fine. They don't interfere with you at all, so it's not like they come into, oh, well, you have to do this mission with this person, so they don't get in your way at all. They're definitely avoidable if you want to, but The cutscenes are fun to watch and it's kind of fun to listen to.
Okay.
I'm worried about for some people out there who just want to play the game. You can definitely, you know, just ignore the cutscenes because they actually have a lot of technical talk in there. I'm surprised about how actually legitimate like hacker talk they have.
Mm-hmm.
But it's still, you know, they make jokes here and there. Like, I was just driving to a mission before he came over, and there's a conversation between one of them, who's a more comical guy, and then Marcus, the main character, and it was just a debate about who would win in a fight, aliens versus predators. It was a very funny topic to go over, and it was literally like a 5-minute conversation.
Yeah.
So I'm glad they filled it with that, making it feel more lifelike. I don't know. Like, I think that you could. It's kind of both ways. I wasn't really worried about them starting the game. I started liking them more and more each mission.
Okay.
But I think that you can definitely skip by them and not miss anything.
Okay.
With the missions, though, here's the cool thing, is that it kind of pops up to where there's side missions and main missions. And instead of actually, you know, Assassin's Creed or other games by Ubisoft, they have, all right, start a mission.
Mm-hmm.
This is going to take a while. There's going to be like an 8-step process. Do this. Then do this, which could take a while. Do this, it could take a while. They did that exact theme where here's a side mission or main mission. You can choose which one you want to do in what order. But each time you do a mission, it's usually about 8 steps. But in between each step, you can go back and do whatever you want to do.
Okay.
So I started this mission. I did the first part. I want to go wander some more. And you can do that.
That's what they started doing with Assassin's Creed after like the second one.
Right. And so, and then you can go do some other side mission, or you can start something else. You can cross them whenever you want to. You don't have to continuously do the same side mission or story mission over and over again or in a row. So that's a nice break.
So with those breaks, does the world feel worth exploring? The first one didn't, like, it felt kind of bland after a little while. Like, there wasn't a lot of diversity. It was, you were in the city, you were in the suburbs. And there wasn't really, it didn't seem like there was a lot of draw to being in either of them, other than you were there for a mission, you were there to go find people or whatever.
Yeah,
but it didn't feel like it was a fun world to live in and play in.
So yeah, I think that's another thing I forgot to mention about the characters, is that they do involve you with everything that you do, even in your systems. So I'm going to answer that question.
Sure.
There's another everything that you do. Everything that you do is based off of your phone.
Okay.
Just like the first one, but it takes up a good portion of the screen. So you can actually, if you're walking by a car and someone's playing music,
mm-hmm.
you can discover it. Like on our phones, what's that app called?
Shazam.
Shazam. You can Shazam other people's music, and then you can add it to your playlist if you want.
Okay.
And that's make your own playlist. There's so many landmarks in San Francisco. They added as many as they can, but what you can do is that you can go, it'll tell you, there's an app that tells you when you're close to one, and if you take a selfie in front of that, you get fans for taking that. And so it also tells you which ones are nearby, how far away are, how many fans you'll get. So you want to kind of go do that as like a, I want to find all the spots, I want to get as many as I can. The cool thing is that your characters who you interact with, they do that as well.
Okay.
So they'll get like, oh, a new update for this app, and I'll show you their selfie in front of one of the landmarks.
Okay.
And underneath each, there's like usually one or two comments making like, don't we have better things to do? And or matching their personality, like, oh man, I was just there yesterday, or like, we should have done this together. Like, and small things like that that make the world feel like it's alive.
Okay.
Also, like with the environment, Chicago was fun, but it was very bland.
Yeah.
I think that, like I said, San Francisco was amazing to look at. It's a beautiful game, except when you're driving on the freeway, then it cuts down the frame rate. But, like, they interact so well with you. You can walk down the street. I found myself walking more than driving. Usually I start the game driving a lot, but I'll find myself walking, and I found two guys who were, one was proposing to the other, right?
Okay.
And then I found this online. There was a scene where a guy proposed to another guy, and the guy tried to do a selfie in front of it, and one of the guys posed for it. He tried to do a photo bomb.
Nice.
And then the guy who's proposing got all pissed off and slapped the other guy.
Yeah.
And then they started getting into a fight, and it was just, like, it's very interactive.
Okay.
You'll find at some bars, there's people outside doing advertising, and they're dressed up different ways. Or you'll find people who are fishing, or Marcus can interact with, like, different emotes. And one's like positive, one's dancing, like one's, you know, talking back. And either like that changes how the people interact with you too.
Okay, I was going to ask that next. Is you're, all right, so it seems like exploring the city is worth it this time around.
Yeah, definitely.
Finding the different locations. And mm-hmm. how does Marcus interacting with the city and the missions that he's going on, the things that he's doing in the storyline, does that affect how the city views him? Do they think he's a savior? Do they think he's a menace? I mean,
so yeah, with this, it's not like Infamous and not like the first one. And the first one, they had a morality meter, and they completely removed that.
Okay,
so there's no morality meter at all. The only thing that's down about that is it also kind of felt like they adjusted it with like the cops, with the wanna levels and things like that.
What do you mean?
So you'll find out if there are gangs, different areas of gangs around California, which of course isn't in real life, but you know, if those areas that come by, it'll say, oh, the 560s are against, in a, you know, against so and so, and so and so is against the 560s. But if you call a gang like with your hacking against that person, they'll also get aggressive with them. But it doesn't affect you in any means.
Okay.
Which is kind of weird. When you're going against the cops, usually like you have your star level. This is your exclamation point level for some reason.
Okay.
It doesn't seem hard to get away from cops.
Okay.
Just like in the first one. That's one thing I think they kept that they should have adjusted more with how real the city feels and how much people are interacting. I feel like they kind of skimped out on the cops' AI intelligence.
Yeah.
Like, I can just drive away at any point, and even if they have a helicopter on me, it's not hard to get away.
Okay.
I don't feel like they try to aim for my tires if I'm driving, or they don't try to do roadblocks as much as they did in the first one, or they didn't try to, you know, block me in or barricade me. It's just like there's no intelligence there for like the cops trying to like doing against me except for shoot at me or chase me.
Yeah.
So I was kind of bummed out about that. I had this missed opportunity. Besides that, the gameplay is really fun. I did a few co-op missions with one of my friends. Is that you can do the entire story and side missions co-oply together. So you can play everything together. It's, and getting very creative with, you know, oh, get these 3 points, and you guys, there'll be like special bonuses like, oh, do two at the same time.
Okay.
And it can be being very creative at the time and solve the
problems. Does the co-op missions handle it the same way as like multiplayer in the first one, where you both see yourself as Marcus and you see the other person you're playing with as a secondary character?
Yeah, so
you're not seeing two Marcuses or something on screen.
Yeah, so in the beginning of the game, it says like Marcus is like looking at his mugshot or like an old criminal record like that, and you get to choose what you want your character to look like there.
Okay.
But when you're playing as Marcus, so the clothes that you buy in a story are like he is online, but you see Marcus. But it's going to look like the character that you chose in the beginning and made in the beginning, just wearing his clothes that he's wearing. So it's kind of both.
So you kind of see like two similar versions of Marcus running around between your character and your friend.
Yeah,
because like in the original one, you're playing as Aiden Pierce. I come join your game. I look like some other civilian character,
right?
While you're Aiden Pierce, but on my screen, I see it reverse, where I'm still Aiden, you're the civilian.
Exactly. So it's still like that.
Okay.
You both still play as Marcus on your game, but when you see the other person, it's going to look like the avatar they chose in the beginning, but dressed as their Marcus.
Okay. Okay. I gotcha.
So.
Makes sense.
Yeah. So, I mean, the only thing you really notice is the face, but you don't really see the face that often. There's actually a lot more multiplayer modes now.
Okay.
I haven't done them all because some of the internet's actually down right now, but it is, there's still a seamless hacking. There's working co-op. There's doing missions together. There's actually like a blitz one where it's PvP but also PvE. There's four different game types in total. So definitely a lot more options for playing multiplayer.
Okay.
And it's all seamless. So you don't really notice like when someone's dropping in your game or not, which is even more of an aspect of things.
Yeah. But, and that was a fun part of the first one too.
Yeah.
How is the character customization? You said that you can get money and be able to buy new clothes and stuff. Is it fairly, does it have like a good range of looks for Marcus? Is it all kind of tailored to the same look? I mean, the first one, obviously you were Aiden and you could choose a different color for your trench coat, but you always looked the same.
Yeah, you always had a trench coat and you always had a hat and mask. So this one's kind of different. You can completely customize your outfit. You can choose your shoes, your pants, your shirt, your glasses, your hat, and also your bag.
Okay.
Because he has his laptop with him at all times. And there's a bunch of different customizations you can do there. I think there's 9 different stores, as well as there's additional premium content that you can get from PlayStation. And then you can mix and match everything.
Okay.
So it's not just one outfit or this. You can customize whatever you want.
You can make him look kind of how you want him to look then.
So there's that. You also can go to a car dealership and buy cars. You can go to bars and tattoo places, whatever you want. Okay. The only thing is that I feel it's kind of another missed opportunity is that you're in California. I know things are verbatim, but you can't buy any property. Hmm. So the only way to get money is by finishing missions or stealing from other people.
Yeah.
Yeah. Now, I mean, if you played the first game, you don't get a lot of money when you steal from other people. It's usually like less than $100.
Yeah.
There is an upgrade, but that gets you only like between $5 to $1,000. And some of the guns cost like $140,000. So, I mean, there's that. I think that having another way of having income mm-hmm. was definitely beneficial, and they kind of missed that opportunity. Or
to Do you think that'll come with the multiplayer stuff, though?
I don't think so.
Okay.
I really don't. I think that also they have like the gangs who are like, oh, there's so many gangs here covering this land. I think that was a missed opportunity because they could have had you have your own gang.
Yeah.
Because you can actually take over multiple headquarters, and they're just spots for you to go hang out at. And there's people in there who aren't part of the main story. They're just characters who are NPCs filling up that space.
Yeah.
I'm like, this would have been cool to have this as a base I purchased. Or for me to select a crew and they do smaller side hacking missions
for me. To go get money for you
like,
and stuff.
Yeah. I think this is a huge missing opportunity. Like when Assassin's Creed did Brotherhood.
Yeah.
And you started being able to tell them what to do. They just missed it on this one. I think that would have made this definitely a notch up in a quality of game.
Okay.
More things for you to do.
All right, so comparing it to Assassin's Creed kind of brings me to, I guess, my last question.
Okay.
Do you see that this series, the Watch Dogs series, it's made a pretty substantial leap from 1 to 2. Do you see it making strides and continuing on? Do you think it'll kind of wear out its welcome like Assassin's Creed did? Where do you kind of see this series going, in your opinion? Do you think it's a series that you would want to keep coming back to?
I think that I would actually like to do maybe one more game. I think that they have maybe one more game in them. If they push more than that, it's going to get dry and not fun. I think that there definitely is a chance for it to still be a better game as well.
Okay.
There's a lot, still a lot of space for improvement.
Yeah, that money thing you mentioned and being able to like have your own gang dead second and whatnot. That would actually be a cool thing to include.
I think there's just a lot of chances for improvement when it comes to, like I said, the world for hacking, being more creative in what they can do for hacks, having a bigger expansive world. I know that there's a lot going on in it, but it's, like I said, it's kind of small. As well as with the story, I feel like the story is not going to wrap up in this one. I feel like there's still more the story can do. I mean, it's a better story, don't get me wrong. Definitely better than the first one, but still not the best or amazing story.
Okay.
I feel like it's not a home run. It's more like, you know, you get a double or a triple out of it. But
yeah,
I would like to see at least one more where they can actually, you know, have a character that matches the scenery in them, and also the hacks they do, or have a character they can play where you can choose if you want to be that character or not, aggressive with guns, or if you want to, instead of just saying, oh, it's a class and not changing the character, but actually have it where his style changes that, or his storyline changes that, or like what you do changes that. That would be very interesting to see. I think they could take a book out of a chapter, a book out of a book. I'll have to trademark that. Let's take a book out of a book on, I think, Heavy Rain story, or even Until Dawn story.
Okay.
Not like so deep and
right,
but I mean to where like if you make this choice in the game or with this storyline, it branches off.
Okay.
Or even Mass Effect where
it locks like, off
five or six choices and you know, change your ending. So.
Yeah.
I think that would be a big chance for them to make a game that's catered to that person's style of gameplay, what type of hacking they want to do, and how their character acts. So,
does Marcus seem like the kind of character that they could base the series around now? Is he a likable enough antagonist like a Nathan Drake, or is he going to be replaced like they do the assassins?
I know a lot of people are liking Marcus. He's a lot of fun and funny. But he's forgettable to me. I think he's going to get replaced. The reason I say that is because, they're DedSec. They're this big organization, which is really just like a handful of people. But they all seem like they're kids. They're all very juvenile. They're all very childish. The way they hack is like middle fingers and Grim Reapers, you know, very cheesy old graphics. Right. And the way they talk is very, you know, early 20s.
That's why I didn't like them in the commercials.
Honestly, when I very first saw the first trailer for the game at E3, mm-hmm. I didn't like the character. I didn't like Marcus. That was one thing that pushed me away.
Yeah.
But the gameplay of hacking is what draws me back in.
Okay.
The ability to change everything. I can, instead of just hacking a car to get into it, I can hack if I want to go straight or turn left or turn right or go in reverse or just turn off.
Okay.
I mean, you have everything available to you for hacking. It's just that you're still locked into the same choices you had for the first one. Just, you know.
Mm-hmm.
I wish they just pushed their boundaries a little bit more. That's what I'd like to see. And looking at the trophies ahead, too, I don't know how the story ends or what's going to happen, but some of the last trophies to the story look the same as the last trophies to the first game. So I'm like, did you guys just repeat yourselves? So I'm waiting to find out. But
so you've had the game since Monday.
So Monday I've had later. The game literally 24 hours right now. Yep, I've been playing the game for about 25 hours.
Yeah.
No, I haven't played 25 hours. It's been released for 25 hours, literally where we're at right now in time. I've played the game for about 14 and a half hours.
Hasn't it been technically 48 hours? Came out Monday night at 10.
Oh, yeah.
It's Wednesday night at 10. So it's been out.
Yeah, 48 hours.
Tuesday to Wednesday.
Sorry.
Yeah.
Okay. So 48 hours, I've played about 13 and a half hours.
Okay, that was going to be my question, was how much time have you put in? About how long, how far are you in the story?
Well,
like, you think?
I'm 40%.
Okay, got it.
On the Uplay account, it tells you your stats and how far you are. So that told me I was 40% into the game first story.
Cool.
Second
time through the story, I'm assuming, right? Because you've had it since Monday.
Well, I mean, get it. Make sure you get every trophy.
That's how you are.
Also, actually, nobody can get the platinum right now because of the outage.
Because of the multiplayer.
Yeah. So there's impossible to get the platinum.
Whoops.
But I really enjoy it. I definitely recommend it. I mean, if you didn't play the first one, you'll be fine playing this one.
Yeah.
You don't need to play the first one.
If you did play the first one, will you like this one more?
Yeah.
Less? I guess it depends on if you like the first one.
But. Yeah, so I mean, I was one of those people who enjoyed the first one.
Yeah, I thought it was enjoyable.
And you'll definitely enjoy this one too. If you didn't play the first one, you'll enjoy this one. If you have no idea about hacking or technology or even what it's about, you'll still find the gameplay fun because of the environment and how you can interact with it.
So something that's interesting this time around, when Watch Dogs 1 released, a lot of it was really cool and being a new next-gen game kind of helps to sell the hacker aspect of it. But now, with shows like Mr. Robot pushing hacker mentality and...
Dang it, you took us on my notes.
I think that's really going to help the franchise for sure, because that series is very popular.
Well, I was actually going to bring up that. I might think that this is only going to help out our having another game a part of the trilogy, because the population nowadays is so obsessed with hacking abilities, with being able to hack, like you said, Mr. Robot, with having this game, with how Anonymous is in our news,
right?
And how Sombra is hacking in Overwatch, like, and how, and I'm going to date myself a little bit here, how The Matrix started off with him being a hacker and going into this world, how in Live Free and Die Hard, Justin Long was a hacker because he's the only one who could stop it because he was a hacker. So, I mean, more and more people are falling in love with the hacker reality. You can go onto websites now about how to learn how to do things, training websites, and they have online classes for hacking. Like
Hugh Jackman was a hacker in Swordfish.
Oh, not really.
Come on, he had like a 6-screen setup. That was amazing.
Yeah.
Made me appreciate multi-monitors.
All I saw was blonde brunette redhead. So but I mean, definitely a good game. Oh, the only concern I have with people who are new to this or want to pick it up and you're kind of an unhyped person, not as an experienced player, there's a lot of controls. So if you're not one who feels comfortable with the controls or the buttons or where everything's at or how to navigate, that might be difficult for you. If you're not good at third-person shooters, this is definitely gonna be hard for you because you have to control the car and your angle and how to hack a lot by moving the camera around. So those are the only difficulties I see, but definitely would recommend picking this game up if you want to explore a fun city, and just interact. You can go be yourself, or you can follow a fun storyline.
Okay.
Neither of them are too difficult.
Cool. Well, after this discussion, it's made me want to play it more. I don't know that I'll necessarily go run out and buy it, but
no, I'll let you borrow it.
I am curious and looking forward to actually kind of playing around in it a little bit. So let's see how it works.
Awesome. Hope I answered all the questions for you.
Yeah, you
cool.
Did a good job.
The only things I had for Quickfire was I want to give a quick shout out to one of our, he's not our Patreons, but he is one of the persons who followed my stream. I did a Let's Play of Watch Dogs from the moment it was released. It's about 3.5 hours, so that's on YouTube if you guys want to check that out. Just search for Taryn the Hype on YouTube. You'll be able to find that video. It's funny because I put it on there from Twitch.
Yeah.
And then just like, I got like 12 emails for copyright infringement for all the songs that were on, that were playing. And I'm like, okay, just remove from my video. So if you hear a lot of audio cutting out, that's YouTube's fault, not mine. But The shout out's going to be for a guy whose username goes by Atarashi B. That's A-T-A-R-A-S-H-I and then capital B. Follow him on Twitch. He was a really nice guy. He stayed on the entire time for the Twitch. You'll see him there. He actually wrote comments and I asked him questions and he asked me questions about the game, what I think, you know.
Nice.
Nice guy. He said he's going to follow me and he followed me the next day. So.
Nice. Very cool.
So shout out to him. Also, if you guys are still wanting to know more information about mud races, there was the world's toughest mudder that took place last week. I'm not going to talk about it, but that's the 24-hour mud racing event. A lot of really cool obstacles. If you can look up tough mudder, go check them out. There's a lot of really cool ones out there. But the last thing, so here's our quick fire before we wrap it up. If there are three things that you'd like to be able to hack, what would they be? Besides the lottery.
Hack GameStop.
No, fuck you guys. Right, so let me ask this question first off. Here's another quick fire.
Okay.
So what type of person would you be if you were a hacker? Would you hack more physically in person or would you hack more only online data mining? How would you, what type of would you hack as if it was a superpower where you could touch things? Like no, stay with me here. Like on the show Heroes, where
you could touch
electronics
seen,
and hack
yeah,
it. Like,
yeah, no,
what
I've,
type of
I've
hacking
seen
ability
those kind
would
of
you
abilities.
Like?
No, it's just funny that you went to the superhero after going from like realistic settings. sorry, I wasn't expecting that. I probably wouldn't. I feel like as a hacker, you're more of an anonymous type of a character personality. You're more behind the screen. So I don't think I would necessarily want to go out and physically be where I'm hacking because that seems counterproductive.
Hey, yo, give me that fucking burger from Burger King. You don't have any money. Oh, check it again. The register's wrong. It says I can have it. Like,
yeah.
No?
No.
Yeah.
I feel like if I was going to hack something, it would be like I feel like I'd be like the altruistic hacker who's trying to expose corporations' dirty secrets or to help people who are like needing... Who
Robin.
Are getting screwed over by corporations and
we'll
that
call
kind of
it
stuff.
The Robin Hood hacker.
Yeah, I'm the Robin Hood hacker. Steal from the rich and I keep it to myself.
And
no,
just,
I'm just kidding. But
I
like,
just take some of the benefits. And I'm reaping
there
a lot
are
of
times
benefits.
When, there are times when I watch Fight Club and I'm like, dang, that would be really nice just to wipe out everybody's credit card debts.
Yeah.
That'd be super nice to wipe out everybody's student loans. I
yes.
mean, there's all kinds of stuff that's like, Sally, these people who are just like, taking so much from regular people and they're just reaping so much rewards off of it that it's like I would like to be able to just kind of give them the finger and be like, hey, screw you, why don't you go try living out on, you know, paycheck to paycheck and seeing how difficult it really is and how much you would appreciate it if someone cut you slack. So I mean that I don't know. That's
I agree. No, that's good.
Probably the way I would hack if I was gonna hack.
Okay. So would you have a signature hack that you would do?
No,
like
that's where they get you. We're the Wet Bandits.
Wow, we are dating ourselves so much with the show. All right, so you wouldn't leave like a white rabbit anywhere?
No, that okay. seems like the dumbest thing to do. Like, I get why people would do it, and
it's like
this
a trademark
thing
or
of,
style sort of thing.
Yeah, and they're like, oh, I want people to know
that's
it was me, and I'd be like, I'd rather just help people. I don't necessarily need the credit, or I don't want to take the credit for it, but
okay.
I want to know that people.
So you've already answered what my other one does. Say, would you do it for good or for bad or just in secret?
I would like to think I would do it for good, but
okay.
I'm sure there's some bad hacking that I would probably get into at some point.
That'd be cool.
For good reasons, but
I thought it'd be cool if you became like a Marvel hero, superhero.
Yeah,
of course, technically. But where hacking wasn't just for digital or electronics, you actually could hack anything. So even other people and like their personality traits or their functions as a human being or like you know diseases, cures, things like that. So,
yeah,
like, get into like the biometrics of it.
Well, technically, there's always evolutions
like
of power
DNA.
Sets.
DNA hacking,
and,
sort of sense.
Yeah.
Like you could fight the X-Men and take away their powers, that sort of thing.
It'd be interesting. That's Dr. Manhattan from Watchmen could do that.
Sorry, I'm a big blue Superman.
It's fine. With his penis hanging out everywhere. Such a
he did go to Bangkok.
Such a weird character. Anyway,
he's going to rock... Well, anyway.
Moving on.
All right, well, that was it, guys. That's going to be the show. We're going to go ahead and wrap up again. We appreciate everything that you guys do. We're listening to the show, watching it, sending emails, comments, following us on Twitter. We actually had a pretty good turnout for checking some of our stats. We've been doing pretty good there.
Cool.
But, guys, we hope to see you guys again on the next episode. Again, I am Taryn with Taryn the Hype. You can either follow me on Twitter at Augie272, Taryn the Hype, T-A-R-Y-N for Taryn.
I am at KrillinFlip337 on Twitter.
And you guys stay.
Tweet much, but you can follow me if you want.
You can pretty much see what I forward him for tweets. but guys, definitely check us out when you can. Again, go to Patreon, subscribe to us if you can, support us if you can even more. You get exclusive access as well as early access to things. I have DLC codes I was giving out for patrons as well as, you know, followers. I might still have some more of those if you subscribe now for Watch Dogs too. But again, YouTube, Twitter, Facebook, PSN, you name it, we're on there. And this is episode 7 of Taryn the Hype podcast. You get to choose the podcast and choose the review. I am so tired right now.
We need to wrap it up.
All right, guys. We'll see you guys next week. Have a great night. You want to do your finger? There you go. All right. Fucking son of a bitch.